Hi, I'm Dr. Kumar. I'm an A&E resident and I'll be going through the topic of near drowning. Well, this topic, these are the main things I'll go through. There are multiple definitions of drowning and submersion injury in the literature. I prefer to use this one, called the Utstein guidelines, and says that drowning refers to a process resulting in primary respiratory impairment from submersion or immersion in a liquid medium. More specifically, in this presentation, we will talk about individuals who suffer near drowning, as opposed to individuals who drown and pass away. So, who suffers from this? Well, a significant number of these cases will be children. 40% of victims are younger than 4 years old. Low and middle income countries have the highest risk of drowning, accounting for over 90% of such fatalities. It is the second most common cause of death in children aged 1 to 14, and is the seventh leading cause of death in unintentional injury or death of all ages. So what happens when a person undergoes the process of drowning? Well, typically it begins with a period of panic. After some initial breath holding, the victim's airway lies below the liquid surface and an involuntary period of laryngeal spasms triggered by the liquid in the oropharynx. At this time, the victim is unable to breathe, causing oxygen depletion or carbon dioxide retention. As the oxygen tension in the blood drops further, laryngeal spasm releases and the victim gasps, hyperventilates, and aspirates variable amounts of liquid. This leads to further hypoxemia. The term wet and dry drowning, you might hear about them, they're not clinically relevant. Dry drowning refers to a process where laryngeal spasm occurs on submersion, preventing water from entering the lungs, as opposed to wet drowning where water enters the lung. This is more relevant to the pathologist. You might also hear the terms fresh or saltwater drowning. So it was believed that hypertonicity of saltwater caused osmosis into the pulmonary interstitium and alveoli, leading to massive pulmonary edema. Drowning in fresh water was thought to create opposite effect. But this distinction is not clinically relevant because it's only seen in pathological specimens where large amounts of fluid is aspirated, causing such effect and leading to the death of the case. So how might these patients present? Well, they might be symptomatic, they might be anxious, tachypneic, dyspneic, hypoxic. They could be coughing, wheezing, basically respiratory symptoms, or having vomiting and diarrhea. They might have other vital signs, including hypothermia, or worse, they can have altered GCS. On the other end of the scale, they might present in cardiovascular arrest. So they might be apneic in asystole in the majority of cases, or also present as VT, VF, or bradycardia. This is probably the most important slide. We must also think of other comorbid conditions when these patients present. They might have had a seizure. They might have used alcohol or other forms of drugs. They could have suffered some trauma, stroke, or MI. They could be hyperglycemic, either as initial presentation leading to their near drowning or as a consequence of their near drowning episode. They could have some primary cardiac arrhythmia. We should also think of child abuse, any psychiatric illness, or whether this was a suicide attempt. Other forms of injury that can be present include baric injury, especially if they were swimming in pressurized conditions, and we should also think of hypothermia. So how do we manage these patients? Out of hospital, resuscitation is very important. So firstly, we need to rapidly excrete them from the water body as cardiac compression is impractical in water. The next important stage is ventilation. As opposed to the normal CPR process where we put C in front of A, in this situation, A comes in front of C. So we'll try to ventilate the patient first. The airway should be cleared of fluid and vomitus. It has also been shown that the Heimlich maneuver is not effective in removing aspirated water. In addition, it delays the start of resuscitation and causes the patient to vomit and aspirate. Cervical spinal cord injury is uncommon in these victims. So unless there's a clinical sign of injury or concerning mechanism, routine cervical spine immobilization is not recommended. Next, when they reach hospital, we will need to oxygenate this individual. Thus, intubation might even be necessary. If the patient remains dyspneic on 100% oxygen or has low oxygen saturation, CPAP can be used. If the PO2 cannot be maintained greater than 60 or 70, then we might need to intubate this patient. This patient might have bronchospasm and we can use azolized bronchodilators. If they have any arrhythmias, we will of course treat them as per ACLS protocols. At the same time, you want to access your ABs and Cs, Ds and Es also. So trauma evaluation should be performed. Any clothing should be removed. Things like ECG, glucose should be assessed. Treatment for hypothermia is currently controversial as hypothermia has been shown to have some neuroprotective effects. And complete recovery of patients with hypothermia and cardiac arrest has been well documented despite prolonged resuscitation. So in the World Congress on Drowning, the following consensus recommendations were made. Drowning victims with restoration of adequate spontaneous circulation who remain comatose should not be actively warmed temperature values above 32 to 34 degrees. So basically, if the patient is hypothermic, you can try to slowly warm him up to 32 to 34 degrees. Other than this, the initial therapy for hypertension would include IV replacement with crystalloids and gastric decompression with nasogastric tube. You might also consider doing them investigations such as full blood count, electrolyte levels, especially acute renal failure has been shown to occur in near drowning. You can also consider doing a lactate level and coagulation profile and other investigations as per necessary, such as ABG, toxicology, blood alcohol level. Chest X-ray will be useful, especially if you suspect aspiration, pulmonary edema, or atelectasis, especially in the presence of foreign bodies. You can also check the position of your endotracheal tube. CT might be necessary as per clinical situation, and you might need to catheterize the patient to measure the urinary output. Symptomatic patients should be admitted to monitor setting while symptoms and physiological disturbances resolve, while asymptomatic patients can be closely observed for approximately 8 hours and admitted if any deterioration occurs. So, what is the prognosis of these patients? Well, these are markers of poor prognosis. Duration of submersion more than 10 minutes, time effective basic life support more than 10 minutes, resuscitation more than 25 minutes, water temperature more than 10 degrees Celsius, age less than 3 degrees, DCS less than 5, persistent apnea requirement of cardiopulmonary resuscitation in the emergency department, and ABG pH of less than 7.1. 30 to 60% of individuals who need continuous CPR on arrival to ED will unfortunately die. But 10 to 20% of patients who present with fixed and dilated pupils can recover, and 75% of near-drowning victims survive. Approximately 6% will suffer a residual neurological deficit. Thus, in summary, it's important to understand the mechanism of near-drowning, how it produces hypoxia, and how this leads to further damage in the body. In the resuscitation process, you must remember always about ventilation and how it is the most important step in the initial treatment of these patients, and rescue breathing should be started as soon as the rescuer reaches shallow water. The hemorrhagic maneuver is not recommended, and cervical spine immobilization is not routinely recommended unless clinically indicated. And we should always think about concomitant conditions that might be present in these patients. These are my references. Thank you very much for listening.